Lawmakers in New York failed to pass a bill legalizing marijuana in the state before the end of the legislative session. So far, roughly 10 states have legalized marijuana, and while proponents argue that it's safe, medical experts are sounding the alarm.
In an op-ed published in the New York Times, Dr. Mary Jeanne Kreek and Dr. Kenneth Davis, physicians argued that the risk marijuana poses to teens and young adults is far greater than ever before. They also argue for a minimum age of 25 when it comes to using marijuana in states where it is in fact legal. Joining us to expand on all of this is Dr. Mary Jeanne Kreek. She is a professor and senior attending physician at Rockefeller University. Dr. Kreek, thanks so much for being with us.
Well, thank you for inviting me. I think this is an extraordinarily important topic to educate the public about at this time.
So tell me what we know about the dangers of marijuana, especially for young brains.
The information comes from many sources. Dr. Davis and I decided to write this op-ed article because the information continues to show us the impact, the negative impact on the developing brain. And with more legalization, we think it's important that people know. The best studies in terms of change in a negative fashion of brain have come from Australia and from New Zealand, where they have done prospective studies to see whether or not the changes in brain function, and including IQ, or better or for worse, measured differently in different places, in persons that use marijuana not at all, minimally, or in heavy use. And what they found in studies of youngsters from early teens up to mid-30s is that the IQ level seems to drop very strongly and significantly in people that are moderate to heavy users. In my own laboratory, we do genetics research, basic neuroscience research in humans, as well as in our mouse and other rodent models. And what we have recently learned in mining the data from 1,500 subjects, all volunteers coming here to Rockefeller University to participate in our research, primarily genetics research, is that those persons who start marijuana use in their teens, 13 to 19, have their heaviest use younger, 17 or 18, and also have a heavier use and earlier use, predicting progression to opiate addiction or cocaine addiction or both. These are very disturbing findings. We're not suggesting a gateway drug. We're simply suggesting that there may be genetic factors that predispose to the early and very heavy cannabis use, or it may be a mixture of genetics and environment. But whatever it is, it does increasingly predict progression to even a more serious addiction like opiate or cocaine addiction.
So, doctor, can we definitively say that marijuana or legalization of marijuana and marijuana use, is it not at least linked to a decrease in opioid use amongst the general population?
It's certainly not linked to a reduction in opiate use. I developed methadone maintenance treatment with a late Dolan, Nice Wander, and then 64 onward, all of the opiate addicted people were usually using marijuana to different degrees, but using marijuana.
Some research has suggested that marijuana can be effective at helping people to get off of opioids, which are more harmful.
I would just speak from my own scientific standpoint and viewpoint, having read the papers and having been in the area of addictive disease research for 50 years. I do not think those studies are credible.
Wow, strong, definitive statement.
It's a very definitive statement. You should speak with Dr. Ken Davis at Mount Sinai. I think he will agree with me 100%. We need more proper studies, mind you, and sadly, they cannot be carried out in humans, can they? It would not be ethical to sort youngsters and put them in a heavy marijuana use and a no marijuana use, and then follow along to see what their opiate use prediction is. And especially since only 1 in 8 to 1 in 15 who ever self-administer opiates become addicted to it.
Another thing that we've seen here is that we've had lawmakers on the show, we've had others who have come, and they have said that we need to deschedule marijuana from a Schedule 1 drug in order to allow medical scientists like yourself to study it. Is that something that you would like to see in order to advance your research?
Absolutely. we have what they call DEA laboratory lysine for research in rodent models in my lab, and it took us over a year to get that permission for Delta 9 THC. That's the active ingredient of marijuana, and it will be amusing to you. There's a second ingredient in the plant called cannabidiol, CBD.
Right.
And there's evidence from very credible research, both in this country and particularly in Israel, that this compound may be beneficial for certain kinds of disorders, including seizure disorders and possibly some inflammatory disorders. This, we all know as scientists, does not bind to the marijuana receptor. It does not alter brain function. It does not alter behavior, but it's scheduled as Schedule 1 in DEA, and my lab is still in the process of getting approval to purchase and study CBD in rodent models. Mm-hmm.
So we do have kind of a natural experiment playing out across the state, since they all have varying levels of access and legality in terms of cannabis. What can we say about places like Colorado, where they have legalized cannabis for recreational use? What has the impact there been on the population?
I think that's a wonderful question. And one thing I hope you and other communicators, which we're not, we're scientists, we communicate at scientific meetings, but I hope you will emphasize the absolute mandatory need and frankly ethical need for states like Colorado, out there the longest, like Washington and Oregon, which have superior medical schools, scientific schools, to count and to find the answer to your question. I have heard reports, which I don't know how credible they are, that emergency room visits have increased markedly in California, that they have included a marked increase in teenagers. But those data are not out there in a crisp, cross-sectional, or prospective way that they should be. And I was in Boston recently talking at Harvard. I made a strong suggestion, since Massachusetts, a place with huge numbers of universities, medical schools, and what have you, that they start prospective studies. I don't know whether they will do so or not, but they're certainly needed. Your point is extraordinarily well taken. We need to look at the natural experiment. However, looking at worldwide as well as US only issues, it would seem that 1 in 8 to 1 in 15 that ever self-administer opiates will become opiate addicted, about the same number, a little bit less for cocaine addiction. And marijuana, the data are sufficiently weak that we cannot say conclusively it's that high, but it may be. Hmm. What we can say is that volunteers just coming to Rockefeller to work with us in genetics research, healthy people, people with opiate addiction, cocaine addiction, or both, we're finding that earlier and heavier use of cannabis is a correlate, not a cause, but a correlate of going on to develop opiate addiction or cocaine addiction.
Final question for you, doctor. Does it make any sense to legalize marijuana across states when we still do not yet know the effects upon teenage brains and upon the general population and the links to opioid abuse like this? Wouldn't it make more sense to study something before legalizing it?
Well, if you ask me, you're not asking the right person. Of course, I think we shouldn't legalize until we know more. Of course, I think. It's just like saying, should we immunize? Well, we've done the studies. We know we should immunize children, and we know that immunization is safe. We tried to limit alcohol, didn't we, during Prohibition? And it didn't work because of increased criminality of a variety of types. But still, the data are out there that earlier use is not good. Use by pregnant mothers is not good. And we could certainly benefit by carrying out rigorous studies supported by states or the federal government in each of the states where legalization has occurred. If I was a policymaker, which I'm not, I would simply say, let's not legalize until we have a lot more data.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much for the work that you're doing, doctor. We
Very
really appreciate
doctor.
You joining us.
Thank you.
Much.
We'll have more Rising for you after this.